Good morning. It's time to get started. I know there's people still coming in, but let's kind of focus and...
I think she's saying wait for a second.
Oh, she's saying wait for a second?
She was kind of putting her hands up.
Okay. I guess we're not ready.
People are still coming in.
How's everybody this morning? Yay! It's September. We made it through the summer months. Yeah. Okay. All right. If you'd like to stand, you may. If not, that's fine. And we're going to be the light of the world, first of all.
I am a light, I am a light, I am a light in this world. I am a light, I am a light, I am a light in this world. And I shine, so bright. And I shine, so bright. You are a light, you are a light, you are a light in this world. You are a light, you are a light, you are a light in this world. And you shine, so bright. And you shine, so bright. We are a light, we are a light, we are a light in this world. We are a light, we are a light, we are a light in this world. And we shine, and we shine so bright. And we shine, and we shine so bright. And we shine, and we shine so bright. And we shine, and we shine so bright.
All right, we're going to do I Love Myself the Way I Am again. And the song is kind of starting to grow on me. I wasn't so sure at first. I realize it's kind of hitting my life as a continuous self-improvement project thing. I'm liking it more and more. I hope you are too.
I love myself the way I am. There's nothing I need to change. I'll always be the perfect me. There's nothing to rearrange. I'm beautiful and capable of being the best me I can. And I love myself just the way I am. I love you the way you are. There's nothing you need to do. Feel the love inside myself. It's easy to love you. Behind your fears, your rage and tears, I see your shining star. And I love you just the way you are. I love the world the way it is, 'cause I can clearly see all the things I judge are done by people just like me. So till the birth of peace on earth that only love can bring, I'll help it grow by loving everything. love myself the way I am. Still I want to grow. The change outside can only come when deep inside I know I'm beautiful and capable of being the best me I can. And I love myself just the way I am.
Yes, I love myself
just the way I am.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for bringing your voices today and reminding all of us that love is really the answer. My name is Teresa Valenzuela, and I am a practitioner here at the Center for the in the Heart of Las Cruces, the Center for Spiritual Living in the Heart of Las Cruces. I'm sorry, I'm with Sarah. I'm still zenned out with that song, and that's okay. Our vision here is a world in loving partnership for the good of all. Welcome to any new people here that are visiting us for the first time. We have some gift bags at either exit, so please pick up a bag before you leave, and there is a coupon in there to be used in our beautiful and wonderful bookstore, and be sure and visit. Look, there's a card in there to leave your information if you'd like, so that Reverend Bonnie can contact you, and we can just get to know you a little better. You're invited to join us for the New Thought Potluck on the fourth Thursday of each month at 11:30 a.m. We had a great turnout last week, so the next one will be September 22nd. Also, we have opened up the social hall after service and ready to have some snack food after service so you can socialize and we can get to know each other. Usually, spirit speaks to me from behind, and they do know how to sign, so I thought maybe there was some interpreting going on. Thank you. We are not a glum lot in this building, I can tell you that for sure. So feel free to bring any cookies or fruit or finger foods. Oh, I see now, Bob was after Sunday service. And so we're also now collecting luggage for foster kids. So any luggage or big travel bags that you have that we can pass on to children in the foster system so they can unpack their big black garbage bags and put their belongings into a real bag. Thank you, Nancy, for bringing that to our attention. We're also getting ready to start Essential Earnest Homes, the class. It begins this coming Thursday from 3 to 6. There is a sign-up sheet right outside to your right in the social hall. So if you have any questions, you can see Reverend Bonnie after service. And it would be wonderful to see you there with us. These are dates to save. September 18th after service, there will be a legacy workshop. After service on September 25th, there'll be a memorial service for Randy Brown. And the treasure sale, the long-awaited fall treasure sale, is the last weekend in October. So start collecting your things. Don't bring them in yet, but start collecting them, and we will be receiving them the second week of October. Outside in the social hall, there's also a sign-up for the Pride booth, which will be on October 1st. The Pride Fiesta is on the plaza, straight down Main Street. So it's always a lot of fun to set up and talk to people and to undo our table afterwards. So sign up to be with us. And also the Ren Faire booth, which is the first Saturday in November, has a sign-up sheet right outside in the social hall. Lots of announcements today, so just stop by the table and see what's going on. We believe in the power of prayer, which we call spiritual mind treatment or affirmative prayer. Please fill out a prayer request, which can be found in pockets on the chair backs. There is a God can in the back as you walk out into the social hall to put your prayer request, or you can drop it into the offering plate on the tables as you exit. Or you can still use our prayer request button on our website. Our prayer team, which is made up of practitioners and ministers from the four local New Thought communities, will pray with you in regards to your request. Also, should you have something you would like a quick prayer treatment for after service, myself and I see Judy, those of us with our stoles, will be up here to receive so we can pray with you and continue the flow of abundance and prosperity. And there's a gratitude card. We'd love to see how Spirit has blessed your life. So there's also gratitude cards in the chair backs, which we joyfully read at every prayer circle that we have on Tuesday. So now it is time for song, silence, and prayer. So coming together and grounding ourselves in gratitude for all that this morning has already brought into our life. And that we know that there is one creative divine mind. That we tap in to that inner knowingness. To bring forth that all that is, all that creates, that came before, is here in the present moment and comes ahead, works in, through, and around us, and is always for us. That this morning has already been blessed, this room is already jiving with blessings, that we can bring laughter and joy into our own hearts and share that with the world. And just so grateful for Reverend Bonnie and her wisdom. Looking at that idea of work and abundance and fulfilling and sharing our gifts. For all the music and technology gurus that come forth every week. For those of you that have been able to join us here this morning in this room. For those that may be in our Zoom room. And for all those that will be watching this on YouTube later on, thank you, thank you, thank you. Your energy and love is one with us right here and right now. It's already done. It is already perfect. We release these words, and as we say, and so it is. So this reading is from this month's Science of Mind magazine, and it comes from the article that Dr. Ernest Holmes wrote, The Secret of Success. And he is going to share a story of a gentleman who is looking for abundance in his life. And this is what Dr. Holmes has to say. We decided it would be a good thing for him to take a few moments each day to meditate and pray with this one idea in mind. God wishes me to be successful. There is an intelligence in the universe that responds to me. There is a law of good that is able to do anything. God is right here where I am. Therefore, I do not have to go anywhere to find him. The law of good is right where I am. Therefore, I do not have to go in search after it. I live and move and have my being in this divine spirit, in this perfect law. I will believe it will respond to me. Therefore, I am going to trust it. Dr. Holmes goes on to say, lessons in trust from nature. He was now trying to accept the answer to his prayer, this gentleman who was looking for some prosperity, even though he had not yet experienced its fulfillment. As Jesus said, when ye pray, believe that ye have, and ye shall receive. Let us say he was in this position. He had a garden plot and seeds to plant in it. He believed the soil could produce the desired crop. He had complete confidence in the creative ability of life, but hadn't actually planted the seed. He was hoping for a crop without having first complied with the law of nature, which says, plant the seed and let the law of good do the rest. Or shall we say that he was like a man who had a hen and a dozen good eggs, and he wanted to raise some chickens. Somehow or other, he had to get the hen and the eggs together. Now, the eggs were willing, and the hen was willing, and he was willing, but if he kept the hen in the yard and the eggs in a basket, nothing would happen. It is necessary to put the eggs under the hen because she knows what to do with them. She just sits on them for 12 days, rolls them around every once in a while, and clucks to herself as she contemplates the happy event that is to take place. You see, the hen doesn't know how to make a chicken any more than you and I know how to create a cabbage. But by some divine guidance, she knows how to sit on them. And there she sits as though she were guided by God's intelligence, which, of course, she really is. But the hen obeys this divine urge within her, and so she sits. And sure enough, in due season, life stirs inside the shells, and the little chicks come forth, ready to start the business of living on their own. Well, you and I are not chickens, and we're not eggs, but we could learn a lot from the hen. Have you and I ever sat on an idea consistently for 21 days without ever leaving it? Have we rolled in over each day in our imagination, like the hen does the eggs, in happy anticipation of what is going to happen? It was exactly this that our friend needed to learn about and what to do. He had already had the makings, so to speak. He merely hadn't put them together correctly. You see, he already had the hen and the eggs with his belief in prayer and his confidence in the power. He just hadn't gotten the eggs under the hen. And so it is.
Sergio's going to sing for us this morning.
Yay!
And I use my little karaoke thing. So to get it ready. you're broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round, and you can't find the fighter, but I see it in you, so we're gonna walk it out and move mountains. We will walk it out, move mountains. And I'll rise like the day. I'll rise unafraid. I'll rise up, and I'll do it 1,000 times again. And I'll rise up, rise like the waves. I'll rise up in spite of the ache. I'll rise up, and I'll do it 1,000 times again. For you, for you, for you, for you. When the silence isn't quiet, and it feels like it's getting hard to breathe, and I know you feel like dying, but I promise we'll take the world to its feet. Move mountains, bring it to its feet. Move mountains. And I'll rise like the day. I'll rise up in spite of the ache. I'll rise up, and I'll do it 1,000 times again. For you, for you, for you, for you. All we need, all we need is hope, and for that we have each other. And for that we have each other. And we will rise, oh, we will rise. I'll rise like the day. I'll rise up in spite of the ache. I will rise 1,000 times again. And we'll rise like the waves. We'll rise unafraid. We'll rise up, and we'll do it 1,000 times again. For you, for you, for you, for you.
Thank you, Sergio. Wow, what a surprise. I wasn't expecting that. Yay, yes, we will rise up. I love it. Well, good morning, everybody. I'm Reverend Bonnie, the community spiritual leader here at the center, and we're moving into a new month where we are looking at celebrating everyday wonder through looking at work. So how many of you are still working? A few, yes. So who thinks this month doesn't pertain to them because our focus is on work? Just you wait and see what we're going to talk about. So when we say the word work, what do you usually think of? What's the first thing that pops in your head when I talk about work?
Hard
a job, employment, retirement. There we go. When we talk about work, what else do we think about?
9 to 5.
Hard work. We usually think, we talk about hard work. What about drudgery? We have to go every day. What about the opposite of play? Sometimes we think of work as the opposite of play. So how does this concept of work then fit into living everyday wonder? And for those of you who are already retired, which I think is the majority of people in this room, how does your living of everyday wonder include work? And does it? Well, consider this. When I became a minister, my brother said to me, "Now your spiritual practice is your work." When he said that to me, it really hit home, because for me to develop that spiritual practice, which included taking time for myself every morning, and it grew from 20 minutes to a half hour to an hour to where I just love as much time as I can get in the mornings to myself. But in order to do that, it was really difficult for me. And now I totally enjoy that time. I cherish my morning time, and I've had people tell me they can tell the difference if I haven't had that time, because I spend that time in prayer and journaling, in processing what's going on in my world, contemplating all these ideas and things that I then get up here and share with all of you. I call that doing my inner work. So when you hear that phrase, doing your inner work, doing my inner work, what do you think of then? Peace? Spirituality? Meditation? Connection? Exploration? Vulnerability. I love it. So that inner work is what helps us to do our healing. It allows healing to take place in and through us. It's that prayer work, it's journaling, it's reading, all of that which we do to support that inner growth that we have. And so if there's inner work, there must be outer work, and we kind of looked at that to begin with. What would that outer work be then? Reading and studying. What else would be outer work? When we think we're doing the inner work, what's outer work?
Smiling at people.
I like that.
Taking care of your health.
Taking care of your health. Volunteering.
Mm-hmm.
Walking. Taking what's in here out into the world. Right? Taking it out into the world outside of yourself, something beyond yourself. It's the work that we do for the greater good, for the world. So why then do we have this outer work? Why do we have work to begin with? I think of it as a way to express ourselves in the world. It's that place where we get to be creative, where we get to figure out how we contribute to the world. And for those of us that still have a job, it's the way that we pay the bills. It's the way we buy our food. It's the way we make our homes comfortable, whether it's with heat and cooling and running water. And then we figure out how to make that keep going beyond that job that we have. Well, my first job when I got out of college, I worked at a factory that made ball uniforms for kids that played Little League during the summer. And my job was to make the little flaps that go on the pockets. Oh, it was so fun. You put two pieces of material in a jig, you stick the jig in the machine, you hit the button, the thing runs through, you pull it out, take that out, put two more in, stick it in, push the button, and around it goes. I was doing that for 9 hours a day. My brain was like, I needed something else to do. So I figured out, I had a piece of paper next to me and a pen, and I'd get the material in there, I'd put the jig in, hit the button, and I'd start writing poetry to the rhythm of the machine. I'd pull it out, I'd do something else, I'd put it in, and I'd keep writing. So I had all this stuff coming through me that I was writing while I was doing this, because I had to keep my mind working, and it wasn't doing anything, just sticking those jigs in. The other piece to that job was then taking that pile. And they had a machine that had a thing that looked like this, and I'd stick it over, I'd step on something, and it would poke down and turn the flap right side out, so then you could stitch it on and have it with the seam on the inside the way it was supposed to when you put it on the uniform. Well, doing that, I found, could be done much quicker if I just took my fingers and flipped them like this, And so my rate, since it was piecework, went sky high. And the managers are, what are you doing? Well, I wasn't using their little jig. I was just using my hands. Well, this went on for just shy of 6 months when I discovered that their way of doing business was all of us temporary workers got laid off just shy of 6 months, so they didn't have to pay unemployment. And the regulars who had been there 20, 30 years were still at their machines for the rest of the summer, making whatever all else they did in that factory. So I had to find another job pretty quickly, and my next job was as an activity director in a nursing home. Now that was fun. I had a blast. I created fun activities for them. We did all kinds of things. I got to take some of them different places. So I really loved that job, and it was from that job that then I discovered deafness and sign language and how I got into my career as a sign language interpreter. And it was also from that job that I came up with my philosophy around work, which was do what my heart desires, do something fun, do something that I enjoy, and create a job around it. Because when they hired me to be the activity director, the manager of the nursing home had no clue what that meant. He just knew that he was required by law to have one. So I was pretty free to create what I wanted to in that job. And it was so much fun. And from that, like I said, my other career also came. And so I started working with the deaf community and interpreting for them. So I agree a lot with this woman who wrote an article in this month's Science of Mind magazine. And she starts her article by saying, "Growing up, my mother would tell me, do what you love and you'll never work a day in your life." I'm sure you've probably heard that. And she says further on in her article, "In my life, the concept of work is less about my profession and more about work as the way I co-create a life of joy with spirit." Co-creating a life of joy with spirit. She says, "Writing does not feel like work to me. Writing is my joy. I'm grateful to have taken my mother's advice, co-creating my life with spirit and feeling like I have never worked a day in my life." And that is the blessing I've had in having the jobs that I've had and being technically hired here at the center. I love my work. It doesn't feel like the way we were defining work at the beginning of this talk. I have been blessed. When I first moved to New Mexico, one of the first jobs I had was working for a place called Adelante in Albuquerque, and my job was to place people with developmental disabilities, and many of them were deaf, in jobs. And what I learned as I had that job was that when people feel valued, when they find ways to have fun and to be creative at their job, and when they have opportunities to connect with other people on the job, they love their job. It doesn't matter what the task is. We were putting people in job clusters that were cleaning the hotel rooms, and they were doing putting those chilies. Did you ever know that all those chili lights that you buy, somebody has to put the chili on the light? We were putting people in the jobs that were putting the chilies on the lights. So they love their jobs because in their clusters, they were able to communicate with each other. They were able to have fun. They were able to connect. And they felt valued, and they were treated well by our teams that put them together and took them out on the job. So that's when I realized it's not so much the task, it's how we feel and what we experience on the job or with the work that we do in the world. So given that, I thought back again to my brother's words that for me were so profound. Now your spiritual practice is your work. What I had struggled with in creating a spiritual practice is I felt like taking an hour or two to myself was a sign of being privileged to a point where I felt like maybe I didn't deserve that much privilege. That felt like indulging. And I should be doing something. You know, I should be doing something productive. So when he told me that now that spiritual practice was my work, It gave it value. I realized how necessary it was, how important it is that I take that time to do the prayer work around the requests that you all send in, that I take the time to hold the center in my prayers to see its continued growth and well-being. That's part of my job. That's the work that I do. And so since the majority of you didn't raise your hands, so the majority of you are either retired or thinking about it, what is your work? We often say that we want world peace. We say from here a lot that we want that world that works for everyone. Do we have that? No. So what is our work? According to Joel Goldsmith, Ernest Holmes, and a lot of our other teachers, our work always begins within. It's that inner work. It's that work that we do daily. And they have encouraged us to take that time on a daily basis to visualize world peace. What would it look like? How would it feel? What would that be as our experience? And to hold our families and our friends in that prayer work, in the light, to take time every day. That is part of our work. In New Thought, when someone asks someone for prayer, you will often hear in response, "I'll work on that." And what are they saying? What does that mean, "I'll work on it"? When somebody says, "Bob, will you pray for me?" "I'll work on it." What does that mean? That means that they are going to take it into their inner work. It means they're going to do the work to change their thinking around whatever it is that you've presented as the issue that wants to be changed or enhanced. It means that they are doing the work internally to open fully to revealing the healing through them and through you for whatever it is you've requested. It means that they're cleaning up their corner of the world with their beliefs, their ideas, so that it improves for everyone who comes into contact with them. It means that on an internal basis, they are creating peace, and that inner peace moves then out into the world to help create world peace. That's the work. In the Science of Mind text, Ernest Holmes talks about treatment and prayer and this work that we do in a lot of places, but here's one where he says, "These are the tools of thought with which a practitioner works." And it's a small p, practitioner, which means any one of us that are practicing these teachings, these principles, these are the tools of thought. Where does he or she do this work? In their own mind. Never anywhere else. Always in their own thought. A practitioner never tries to get away from the mind within. And in another spot, talking about treatment, which is what we refer to as affirmative prayer, that prayer work that we do. A treatment is a spiritual entity in the mental world and is equipped with power and volition, as much power and volition as there is faith in it, given to it by the mind of the one using it. And operating through the law, it knows exactly how to work. So when we put those thoughts into the law, it already knows how to do the work and what methods to use and just how to use them. We do not put the power into the word, but we do let the power of the law flow through it. And the one who most completely believes in this power will produce the best results. This is the law of cause and effect again. So that is the type of thing we're talking about when we're talking about doing our work. It's how we put prayer into motion. It's how we think about the world around us and what power we're giving it. Now, because so many of you have been in this so long, I know many of you have been studying for years, you might be thinking, "I've mastered this. I've got the perfect life right now. I've created everything that I want. I'm retired. I'm comfortable. I get to go and do anything that I want." Anybody? Yeah? Anybody out there? In other words, you've mastered all those principles, and you've got that law of attraction working for you perfectly. You're just rolling along, and life is good. And if that's true, and I hope it is for some of you, is your work done? No. No. And so it was interesting. This month, I got another Spirituality and Health magazine, And this is not traditionally part of our movement, but I love this magazine. And in here was an article, Rethinking the Law of Attraction. And it spoke to a lot of what we teach. The law of attraction suggests that the energy we put into the world through our thoughts and words is responsible for the results we draw into our lives. For many people, the law of attraction offers an effective vehicle for growing personal agency, decision-making, and power. When followed uncritically, the law of attraction leads some practitioners, small p, to blame difficult life circumstances on low vibrational thoughts, when the real culprit is often systematic oppression, mental illness, or other conditions beyond personal control. Ooh, yeah, when I read that, it was like, ah, that's something I've wondered about since the day I started reading this. When I started reading the Science of Mind text, I thought, well, this is great for someone who has their full mental capacities. What about those who don't? What about all those developmentally disabled people I've worked with throughout my life who couldn't read the vocabulary in a book like this? What happens then? What happens when we believe that this teaching and this truth applies to all? Further on, this author says, it's true that the law of attraction can empower us to change our circumstances, even within harmful systems of oppression, by showing us how we can be proactive co-creators of our realities. But this should not prevent us from also seeking to change those systems. And that also spoke to me. Some of that work that I think is left to do. And she gives a really good example here of two runners, people that are running as I guess a profession, really. So returning to the running analogy, she says, we all have access to the same laws of biomechanics, physiology, and physics. But compare two different runners. One has the newest $200 Nikes, eating a nutritionist-prescribed breakfast to maximize energy efficiency, and competes at a professional track near her home. The other runner laces up secondhand track shoes and has breakfast at a gas station because this bus takes 40 minutes to get her to the track meet. These runners both exist in a reality shaped by universal laws, but the condition under which they run is not universal. As a result, the ease with which these runners can apply the laws of biomechanics, physiology, physics is not universal, and I would say even spiritual principle isn't going to be the same given their circumstances. This is a systematic problem, not an individual one. And I think often as we work with people and teach them what we believe, it's important to remember, where are they coming out of? What are their circumstances? This person says, handing someone a tool, whether it's the law of attraction, growth mindset, or any other self-development concept, and then judging them based on their ability to bootstrap their way through obstacles is unjust. When we move beyond focusing only on individual benefits, and I took that to mean our benefits, we've got it working for us. When we move beyond focusing only on individual benefits through individual action, we gain access to one of the most powerful manifestation techniques, activating collective consciousness. Simply put, we are more powerful together. And the conclusion to this article, all of us can begin to see the world in life code, Brown writes, awakening to the sacred systems of life all around us. I would say principle, that's what we teach. If you are a law of attraction practitioner, you're already conscious that life code exists. Now your task is to take this knowledge and use it to align, amplify, and focus your thoughts for the common good. Imagine the ripple effect we can create by tapping into our collective consciousness and co-creating a world that values all of us equally. So to me, that's taking all this work that we do, all that inner work that we do, and moving it to that next level, the work that we still have to do to work on those systems in the world around us that still need to be shifted and changed and moved so that everyone really is working on an equal playing field. So, to me, our work is not done until all aspects of us, and I'm referring to the one that we are all a part of, till all of us are expressing to our highest and best abilities, and that we're all working within a field that provides us with equal opportunities and abilities to use these skills and these tools. So, in my mind, this work isn't necessarily difficult. It's not hard, so to speak. It doesn't take a lot of work, but it does require showing up. It does require taking the time to go within and do that inner work, and then staying aware of what's going on in the world around you and how you can bring that into those places. Recently, there's been an example in my life and the life of my partner, Shauna, and actually all of your lives, but you probably weren't even aware of it. And that example is that Shauna and her housemate live in a neighborhood where the neighbors all watch out for each other. They're on a cul-de-sac. And one of their neighbors over the years has been collecting things in the house to the point where she can't even move through her house. She was unable to get to her refrigerator anymore. The stuff was starting to move out into the yard and into the backyard. And they noticed that she was sleeping in a chair in the front yard, and she was having food and ice delivered during the summer and during COVID. And she was eating out of a cooler where she was keeping her food in the front yard. And here, we had someone bring us that beautiful chrome refrigerator. I don't know if you've noticed our new refrigerator in there. So the refrigerator we had got moved into the children's area. That was originally donated to us as well. And so I told Shauna, I said, we've got a refrigerator if we could figure out a way for this woman to be able to use it. Well, we didn't want it on the front porch. So they told her, if you'll clear off your back patio, your back porch, it's over, it's got a ceiling, a roof to it, a cover. They said, we have a refrigerator we can give you. Well, a week went by, there were the rains, and she wasn't really getting very far. Oh, and the community, the neighbors had all bought a huge bin, a huge trash bin, and or rented it and had it there, hoping that she would be inspired to clear out some of her things. And that had been there for a while. So we kept looking and hoping that we would start to see things pile up in there. And so we told her again, you have one more week that we will keep that refrigerator in our kids' space here for you to clear out room for a refrigerator. She got a friend and she actually did it. She cleared that space. We got the refrigerator moved onto her back patio. And the comment that she made to Shauna was, I now feel human again. So this community impacted. She knows that it came from our community. She knows that it was a gift from this community. And I saw that as this chain of events. First, Ken and Tanya give us their refrigerator. Then Dorothy Taylor gives us one and we shift that out. Then we see a need and we encourage this person to take care of her space. Now, in fact, she started clearing on the inside. So it's got her moving and she has help and she knows that people care about her. I feel human again. What an impact that chain of events has taken in her life. And so to me, that is an example of how each person in that chain just does the next thing, makes a donation, does something. You'd never know what those little steps are going to do to improve and uplift another person's life and to make a huge difference. And every one person who's had a change and an impact in their life is part of the one that we are all a part of. It's impacting all of us in a positive way. So I think back and I look at all of our lives, and when our kids leave home, when we retire, when we make huge changes, maybe when we move, we might think, oh, my role is over, my job is done. But our work is not done. Our work is our purpose, and our purpose is our work. And it always starts within. It always starts inside. And so I want to take us back to the story of the hen with the eggs. And if you read in The Science of Mind, you can read the whole story. But Ernest Holmes goes on to say, after he said he just didn't have the eggs under the hen, he says, well, this man really sat on his eggs for 3 months before anything happened. But he did sit on them. He did roll them over in his imagination every day. That is, he had a quiet period each day when he dedicated and prayed and generated faith and conviction and came to a complete acceptance. He was waiting in faith, waiting on the law of good and resting in the knowledge that God never lets anyone down. I used to ask him from time to time, "How is it with your faith? Are you anxious? Do you have any doubts that come into mind?" And he would always say, "No, I am sure something good is going to happen." And sure enough, one day it did, and you can read about it if you want to do that. But I thought, what a great story, what a great analogy, that our job is to do that inner work that gets those eggs under the hen. We roll them around, we contemplate them, and we wait with excited expectancy for what it is they're going to produce in our lives. We think about, where can we shine our light? Every little place along the way. How can we impact change in places where it's still unfair or unequal, where there isn't equity? How can we make a difference? Well, as I kept thinking about work, this song kept coming to me. Hi-ho, hi-ho, it's off to work we go. So that's been going through my mind as I think about the spiritual work. It's off to do that spiritual work, because that spiritual work brings peace and joy. And so I can sing that song with that same excitement that those little dwarfs sang. Hi-ho, hi-ho, it's off to work we go. We feel like we've never worked a day in our lives when we do that. Now, I do have to admit that there are times when I would rather just stay home and work in my garden and not go to the places that are paying me to work. But then I remember that I love my home, I like running water, I like my car, I want to have heat and cooling, so I have to change my thoughts and the words that I use and move into gratitude. I am grateful when the university calls me and says, "Do you want to interpret?" I am grateful for that offer. I am grateful to say yes. I'm grateful for every day I get to come here and be a part of this center. So I move into gratitude because that also is part of the joy that this work brings. I'm grateful for the work of Spirit in and through me. I've shared before that once I took foundations, I determined that my purpose in life was to give God a good time through me. And how that outpictures what that means evolves, but I'm constantly asking myself, is God having a good time? Emma Curtis Hopkins said, "Your good is your God." So what is that good that I can do, and what is that good that I can be in the world? And again, another story to share with you. Recently, Shauna and I took a friend who was visiting from out of town to White Sands. And so, of course, we stopped in the museum and gift store first to show her all that before we were going to drive into White Sands. When we got back out into the car, the battery had died. Now, I don't know if you've ever tried to use your cell phone out at White Sands. It's very hard. You have very few bars, and I was down to like 20% of my cell phone anyway. So I went inside with my cord and asked the ranger, "Can I plug in?" She let me plug in, and I'm on the phone trying to get a hold of AAA, and Shauna's sitting near the door when a woman came in, sat down, clearly distressed, very red. She was overheated. Shauna used to be an EMT. She quickly got the ranger to bring ice to help. I ran to the car, got bottles of water for her and the other people she was riding on a motorcycle with. And Shauna said, "This is why we're here." So instead of getting angry that our battery had died, we saw that we had a purpose to be delayed. We had a purpose to help this individual, one person, again, a chain of events where we were able to help one individual get back on the road and be safe. So our work is to stay centered. Our work is to trust, even when the battery dies, that we're here for a purpose. There's something that is delaying us for a reason. And to keep stay open to what our purpose is and how we can be the light in that moment. Now, the next time I speak, I'm going to be looking at what is ours to do in terms of work. But for now, I really want to emphasize that as we go into this month celebrating everyday wonder through work, that even though you might not have a paying job, your work is not done. that there is a lot to be said and a lot to learn as we focus on what is our work? What is the work that is still ours, that is still being done through us? Our work isn't done till we're done. And then we never know, it might continue into the next experience. So our work is to get those eggs under the hen, to do that inner work within ourselves, to sit on whatever it is we're wanting to see in the world, roll it over. I love that idea of rolling it over, contemplating it, and with excitement, waiting to see how it manifests in the world. Staying in prayer and contemplation as we take that time each day to do our spiritual work. We allow our inner work to make us sing, to make us feel good about our work so we feel like we've never worked a day in our lives. So will you sing with me? Hi-ho, hi-ho, it's off to work we go. And so it is. Good job, y'all. Good job. So will the practitioners please surround this room and know that they love their work. We all love to pray. That's why we get continue to take classes and move along this path. So know that they love the work, and if you'll give them something to pray about after the service, they'll be happy. They'll be singing, right? All of you? So let's just take it within. As we breathe into that heart space, that place where spirit is moving in and through us always, we can ask ourselves, what is our work? What is the work yet to be done? What is spirit wanting to do through us? We allow ourselves to listen to those inspirational thoughts. We allow ourselves to see them like an egg that we'll sit on and just contemplate. Nothing really to do, just let the law work through and inspire us. And when that egg is ready to hatch, it will hatch. So I'm grateful for this teaching and for these wonderful analogies that Ernest Holmes has given us, and for the joy of doing this work on a daily basis, for the blessing of having the time and the opportunity to do the inner work, that spiritual work that buoys us up as we move through the world. And so I know each one of us finds a way to have that time in contemplation, to give ourselves that gift of doing our inner work and staying open to how we take that work out into the world. What is yet to be done? Where are we to shine our light? I am so grateful for this time and this community and this teaching. And so I know that together we are all saying in our hearts and out loud, and so it is. Thank you.
Thank you, practitioners.
All right, I know you guys are all just really wanting to sing this hi-ho thing, so here we go. And the second verse has a whistling part, and I am not a whistler, so please help.
Troubles go, just keep on singing all day long. Hi ho, hi ho, hi ho, hi ho, hi ho. For if you're feeling low, you positively can't go wrong with a hi. Hi ho, hi ho, hi ho, hi ho. It's home from work we go. Do 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 do. Hi ho.
That's great, and look at how I remembered it. I saw it as off to work. It's home from work. That's even better, isn't it? It's our home, and it's our home where we do the work, and we take it out, and we come back to it. So I love it. Hopefully you'll be singing that all week long. That'll stick with you.
I have been singing. I woke up singing it.
You woke up singing it?
I did.
Thank you, Sarah, for bringing that to us. And so now is the time when we consider how it is that we give back to this wonderful center that supports us in so many ways. And just know that we have opportunities online as well as here. There's we're not passing the plate, so to speak, but there's places to put any donations at both doors. And this month, being a new month, we are tithing 10% of all that comes through here to the Amador Health Center, where they believe that every person has the right to be seen and treated regardless of insurance coverage, criminal background, immigration status, sexual orientation, drug use, or ability to pay. Talk about including all in the one. By staying tuned to this, true to this core belief, our Las Cruces Health Center has enabled countless residents to find the care they need to build a stronger life. If you're in need of medical care, behavioral health care, drug or alcohol recovery, or are just looking for a network of support, Amador Health Center's doors are open to you. And so we are supporting them with 10% of all that comes through the center this month. So let us sing together, or say together, first of all. Click, click. Well. There we go. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Thank you, God, in me. And we'll sing together, I am so blessed. And I hope you feel it. I hope you feel blessed today.
I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so grateful for all that I have. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so grateful. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so blessed. I am so grateful for all that I have. I am so blessed.
Well, I certainly feel blessed this morning. Thank you all for being here. And please bless the practitioners and let them pray with you and put in your prayer requests if you like. And it's anything you want to see enhanced, any that world peace that we're looking for, anything that you want to see changed. We're here to support you in prayer. That's where it starts, that inner work. So please remember that they're ready to work with you after the service. Now we shall close by singing
the peace song.
The peace song. So let's stand.
Each moment in peace, eternal.